that with me. Father, right now, I lift my friend Jackie to you. And I love Jackie. And I, Lord, as we were texting last night, I just bless my brother. Lord, I can't even imagine. But Lord, I thank you. You're greater than what I can imagine. You're deeper, you're wider, you're higher. And Lord, this spirit of death and this spirit of disease that Thomas was talking about, Lord, I thank you that we do have authority over it. I thank you that we do.
Yes, Jesus.
And I thank you, Lord. But when these things hit, take life from the earth, Lord, it does hurt our heart. My heart is broken with Jackie this morning, with Dr. Graves, with Todd. I can't think of the little Hannah Grace is 10 years old and her mama's in heaven. So, Lord, I ask you to just comfort. Lord, just comfort. Sammy's family. Lord, his sister and dad. Lord, I talked to Mr. Funderburk over at the post office, and he hugged my neck with tears. He's saying, "Preacher, I was supposed to outlive my son." Mr. Sammy's dad's 87, turning 88. Matter of fact, he just turned 88 the other day. And he said, "I was supposed to outlive my son." I hugged his neck and prayed with him. And there's Vicky. And then think about Larry Miller. One of his brothers passed this week. We went to that funeral. So, Lord, thank you that you're comforting your people. And I thank you that you're going to give us great victory over the serpent and the scorpion. The serpent is the curse of the law, and the scorpion is the sting of death. So right now, I just proclaim life over this congregation. And all of those who relate to us and all of those who related to us, we agree with life. You came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. You took our death on the tree. You took our death and you took our curse on the tree. You bore who and what we were. You bore the law of sin and death on that tree. You took it for 3 days and three nights, and you rose from the dead. We've already sang it this morning. He's alive. He lives, and his life is our life. And as he is, so are we in this world. We agree. We agree. We set ourselves in agreement with the very life and nature of Jesus. Jesus living in the heavens, but Jesus living in our hearts. And I pray right now you'd strengthen us and you'd help us as we worship you today. And Lord, as we transition from being vertical before you, worshiping, into ministering to one another horizontal, I pray that you'd fill this room with love and grace. I pray that you let us be compassionate one to another, receive one another in love. And I thank you for every person in this room, every person under the sound of my voice, that you bless us now in Jesus' name. And in agreement with that, we said together, amen. And if you'll remain standing while the ushers come forward, ushers, if you'll come with me, if you'll remain standing, we're going to receive the tithe and offering and then fellowship as we do. We call this the love feast. We believe in feasting. Praise God. Amen. If it's worth meeting over, it's worth eating over. Hallelujah. Praise God. God is good. And you're a blessed people. And you're a free people. You're an anointed, appointed, ordained people in Christ Jesus. Well, it's the end of the month. It's time to give and sow seed. I love to give, don't you? I love to bless. I love to sow seed. And the tithe is holy unto the Lord. And I'm so thankful that God has brought us to a place where we understand that Levi paid tithes in the old covenant, but Abraham gave tithes. And I don't pay anything. I don't owe God anything because Jesus paid my debt. If he didn't pay it all, then he didn't pay it all and we're all in trouble. He paid my debt to the Father. But now it's my joy to give. I love to give. I love to sow. I love to bless. So all of you know, the mortgage payment on this property comes due at the end of the month. We're there. This is it. It's the last offering for the month. And so I need your help today. I'd love to stroke a check myself, but I'm not quite there today. This ain't quite going to do it. I got my check ready. It's not quite going to make what we need, but I'm glad you're here, and I appreciate you giving and sowing. Your giving is so precious to the Lord, and your giving is precious to my heart. I deeply, deeply appreciate you and your faithfulness and your finances. Father, we thank you that our needs are met. We thank you we have plenty more to lay in store, to sow seed, to bless, to go beyond this house till we can give. Lord, we can give to the ministries that we're incorporated with and sow into and bless and tithe up to and honor. We thank you that every need here is met locally. We thank you we have seed to sow into the community. And I thank you that you're blessing us. And we thank you for your rich, full blessing on us financially. We receive, we thank you, we praise you, and we give you honor and praise. In Jesus' name, thank you. Our needs are met. And we said together, amen. Now remember, the Father is feeding that sparrow. And he's clothing that lily with a greater glory than Solomon had. And Jesus said, if indeed he fed the sparrow and he clothed the lily with a greater glory, shall he not much more clothe and feed you? And then Jesus said, oh, you of little faith. And then he smiled and said, listen, don't seek what you're going to eat or drink or wear. Don't do that. The Gentiles seek all these things, but seek you first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, not yours, His righteousness. That's Jesus, His righteousness. And all these things shall be added to you. And then He said, and don't take thought of tomorrow, because sufficient is the evil there. We're not concerned about tomorrow. We just live in now. And the seed we sow today will show up in our harvest tomorrow. It always does. Amen? All right. God bless you. Bring the tithe and offering. Let's rejoice. Hug one another's neck. Let's fill this room for about 5 minutes with good old-fashioned Christian love. God bless you. right, when you get back to your seat, if you'll remain standing with me. And all right. You remain standing, please. Teresa has an announcement first, and then we'll go to the board quickly. So please pay attention, everybody. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time. Amen. It's so good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. I'm very thankful that we have the opportunity to come and gather to worship Him together in spirit and in truth. Amen. I do have all the financial statements ready, so if you will see me after church, I have yours. And also, there will be an announcement on the board in just a minute. Or, Sondra, can you pull it up for me, the ladies' announcement? She's trying to get it right now. On February the 12th, it's a Sunday afternoon from 4 to 6, I would like to invite all of you ladies, and young ladies, Autumn and Aaron, if you are a teenager, you're more than welcome to come too. But for all ladies, we're going to be coming and gathering from 4 to 6. The Lord put it on my heart to call this, you are valuable. You are valuable. And we're going to be having a tea. And you might say, I don't like hot tea. I don't like tea. That's not me. Hey, we will have soda. We'll mix you up a drink real quick with some ice and maybe some, like last night it was Diet Pepsi and Diet Mountain Dew. Pastor's like, oh, mix it up. But hey, if you want a soda, we will have soda. But this is something for us to come together. We're going to be getting more things going, and this is a kickoff. And we really want you to come out and be a part of this. Miss Dreama is going to be sharing with us. And just some good things will be happening that afternoon from 4 to 6. So please mark your calendars now. I have an invite for you after church, so please see me so I can give it to you and you can take it home. Put it on your refrigerator or wherever you will see it, so it will remind you not to make any other plans, okay? But this is a time, and you know when you can sit down beside somebody and talk and share with them, you can find out more about them and you can feel their heart. So this is a time for us to come together for fellowship, but for love and unity. So please, February the 12th, okay? Please. Yes. 4 to 6. Please mark your calendar. See me after church for your tithe record and your giving record and the invitations, okay? So I'm looking forward to seeing you all there. Jazz. Melinda. Brenda. Joyce. Cheryl.
Okay.
I'm not done yet.
It's time to move on.
We just want y'all to all come feel welcome, okay? And we know that Pastor will come around and be spying in the door at us because he's nosy. Okay. I love you. Bless you.
All right. Dangerous to let anybody in your family have a microphone. Dangerous. All right. Tuesday prayer service, 6 p.m. here at the church. Midweek service every Wednesday. We study the Word. Sunday mornings, 9:30. We have discipleship class with Pastor Slater. This evening, we have a time in the Spirit. Going to be in the fellowship hall ministering. And we have some special guests with us. Thornton's here today. And we love Thornton. And Sammy's with him. It's good to see you, Sammy. And we have Malcolm. Are you from Houston? You're from Houston, so he's Houston. And Malcolm and I get along really well. He tells really good jokes. I'll just say that and meddle him right along. Pretty funny last night. And Jacqueline from Denver, right? Denver, Colorado. So what we're going to do this evening, we're going to get together and just stir up the gift in people. We're going to lay hands on people, minister of the Holy Spirit. I don't even know exactly what we'll do, but we're going to share and minister. So if you can come, like to come, want more of the Holy Spirit, I invite all of you to come and just have hands laid on you, operate in the gifts. There's a lot of things. They stir up things that I don't necessarily have. I'm much more apostolic in foundation. So if you can come, we want to invite you to come to that in the fellowship hall. It's going to be a good week, a busy week. It's going to be a great week. Amen? And it starts off tonight. So please plan on being with us if you can. We appreciate that so much. All right. We have the tax statements there ready. Thank you for your giving and all the seeds you sow. For this size group of people, we're able to do a lot. God's been good to us. We're able to do so much, and we're believing God for to do more. And please, when you get your tax returns back, sow a seed out of your tax return just to bless the house of the Lord. All right? Some of you get $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 back, sow a seed out of that. Amen? Because I preach on inheritance so much, a lot of people think I don't believe in sowing, but you know, I do believe in sowing seed. Praise God. You know, there's a harvest and there's an inheritance. If you had anything to do with it, it's not your inheritance, it's your harvest. Your harvest comes freely by what Jesus did. Your inheritance comes from the seed you sow, or rather your harvest comes from the seed you sow. So which one's true? They're both true. Which one do we want? Both. We want both. We don't have to choose. That's good news. All right? All right. You ready? Let's say it together. Amen. Our vision is Jesus Christ. Our mission is to preach, teach, and exalt the Lord Jesus Christ in all the fullness of His glory and power, and to radiate His love to our community and unto all the world. Amen. And so we're praying for Richard and Iris Pringle and their family this week. Bless Richard, one of our elders. And we're very thankful for all of you. God bless you. Welcome to the house of the Lord. Randy asked us to pray for his eyes. And Miss Nancy, how are you feeling this morning? You doing better? Believe in God? You better? Believe God, you're healed, right? Okay. All right. I want to pray for both of you right now. Father, I thank you for Nancy and I thank you for Randy, Lord. I thank you for Nancy's body being healed. I thank you for Randy being healed in his eyes. I thank you, Lord. You're working, you're powerfully working in us, bringing forth your life, spirit, soul, and body in us to your glory, to your honor, and I thank you and praise you for it. We give you praise. Now bless our children, our young people, the nursery ministry, and we who stay in the auditorium as we open your word. I pray very humbly, reverently, that your word will open unto us. I pray that you will give us wisdom and revelation, understanding from your heart, that we will know your mind, your thought. We want to know what you know. We want to believe what you believe. We want to flow with you. I pray that you direct each teacher and direct me as I teach this morning. Thank you for the anointing to impart apostolic foundation and grace. And we thank you and praise you. Jesus is glorified, revealed. And we thank you that the people receive blessing and favor, grace and mercy. It's multiplied to them. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. And I thank you for it in Jesus' name. Good seed on good ground, producing good fruit to your glory. That's what we believe. We'll never be the same. We're changed in Jesus' name. And we all said together, amen. All right, children, young people, you may go. And if you're in the auditorium, you can open with me now to the book of Leviticus chapter 25. We've got about 9 minutes to beat the Baptist to the steakhouse. I don't think we're going to make it. We're going to a spiritual steakhouse, but we're not going to beat the Baptist to the steakhouse. Everybody say, God bless the Baptists. There's more Baptists than there are people. Praise God. More Baptists than there are people. There are Baptists everywhere. God bless the Baptists. They're good people. All right. We're studying the subject of rejuvenation in body from the thought and the life of Abraham. 99 years old, God quickened him. And God made him live and God breathed into him. And God began to reveal and unveil what his plan was for man through the prophet of God, Abraham, and through the servant of God, Abraham. And so we've been looking at this reality because we're heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. Because we're heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, it is written, Romans 8:17, we are beyond controversy. It is written, then what belongs to Jesus belongs to us. And we know Jesus already has a resurrected and glorified body. Now, we don't yet have a glorified body, yet we do have a right to have a rejuvenated body. Gentlemen, the Bible calls us sons of Abraham. Ladies, the Bible calls you daughters of Sarah. Now, what's interesting about that is that they're the only two that received rejuvenation in their body. They received something that no one else in the Bible received. And we are called sons of Abraham, and you ladies are daughters of Sarah. So we have a right through scriptural identification to agree with what God did in Abraham's body. Abraham's body now dead, neither did he consider yet the deadness of Sarah's womb, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. God quickened him, and Abraham, by that quickening, through that work that God did in his body, lived 76 more years in strength and health and power. How'd you like to live 75 more years in strength and power? The days of man shall be 120 years. And that's just as much word of God as any other word in the Bible. However, I do know this to be true. It won't work until somebody believes it. The word works effectually in you which believe. So we've been studying this thought of rejuvenation in body and healing. And with everything that's going on in the body of Christ, I have reports from everywhere of people being attacked and maligned with sickness and disease and serious things that are crippling people and hurting people. Then God's people need to understand this message so we can walk in health. And the reason we need our health is so we can do the work of the Master. If you lose your mobility, you lose your ability to go in the earth. There's some people that have lost their mobility. God can't say go to China. They've lost their mobility. So God wants us to have our mobility in the earth so we can move at His command. Health and strength is not just so you can sit up in a bed and watch TV without back pain. Or so you can play tennis without your elbow hurting. There's a much more worthy cause than playing tennis or watching TV. And nothing wrong with either one of those things in moderation and measure. But God wants you to have health and strength for His service and His glory. So we're sounding these trumpets of healing. So let's read from Leviticus 25 and we'll get back to these thoughts. And I want to sound the trumpet of new covenant healing this morning. Are you ready to study? Leviticus 25:9. Then thou shalt cause the trumpet of jubilee to sound on the 10th day of the month in the day of atonement. Ye shall make the trumpet sound throughout all your land. Now notice, this is not what God does. You make the trumpet sound. And your trumpet is what you say with your mouth and believe in your heart. And you shall hollow the 50th year and proclaim liberty throughout all the land. So today my spiritual, mental, physical, social, financial land is free. He said, proclaim liberty to all your land and unto all the inhabitants thereof. So anybody that comes in the sphere of my land, if I deal with anybody spiritually, mentally, physically, socially, or financially, then I proclaim liberty to them. If you come in the sphere of my life, then I have a right to proclaim liberty to you. We had a woman come in the church last Sunday night while I was preaching a second time to be in that church in her life, elderly woman. We all came to the altar. We all began to pray and seek God. She passed out. She had all evidence of a massive stroke. The right side of her face went paralyzed. Her eye began to droop. Her speech was slurred. She lost continence in her bowels. It was pretty ugly. And I just finished preaching on the sound of freedom in the church. Now that woman's in my land. She came into that church. And so myself and the pastor's wife and another lady named Donna, who's experienced healing from throat cancer, we got down beside her, and I got right down on my knees where she was. She's passed out on the front row, and I began to command her to live in Jesus' name, because by all appearances, she was at death's door, ready to die. And at a couple points, my natural mind told me she had died. So we laid hands on her and commanded her. Her name was Catherine. I commanded her to come back in Jesus' name. Somebody slipped out and called the paramedics. They came, got her, and they took her to the hospital. And by the time I left the building, which was about 30 minutes after that, they came back and said, Catherine is fine. Catherine as well. Catherine sitting up in the bed, and Catherine came home Sunday night. Praise God. Did she have a stroke? I don't know. It looked like she did. I was with Tiffany, who's Rob's daughter, who's like a daughter to me, and Tiffany's studying occupational therapy, and she's ready to graduate her doctorate program. And she said, by all appearance, Pastor John, it looks like she's had a massive stroke. Tiffany studies that every day and works with generic patients and sees that all the time. And she's that looks very serious. And that's when you have to proclaim liberty throughout all your land to all the inhabitants thereof. So if anybody comes in our land, praise God, they're free. Steve Housewell and I were in Roanoke about 10 months ago. And I walked up to the counter, and there was a young man there that had a spirit of homosexuality on him. And when I was in a hurry, and I was pressing to get there because I had to change and get to church and preach the gospel. And sometimes when you get pressed, you forget who's living in you and who you are in Christ. It's easy to get out of that consciousness. And when I walked up to that counter, I was very stunned and struck by the spirit of homosexuality in this young man. It was evident. It was dripping off him. He was saturated with it. And so I was a little bit bothered by that because I said, Lord, I'm full of the Holy Ghost. And when I walk up to this counter, I should not feel what he has. He should feel what I have. So I stepped back, and there was another gentleman there, and Steve said, what are you doing? I said, let that guy go first. And I stepped back and I said, Lord, just want you to forgive me. I just lost consciousness of who you are in me. And when I step back up there, I thank you. You're going to help me minister to this young man, and your presence is going to overwhelm him. I'm not about to be overwhelmed by a spirit of homosexuality when the greater one lives in me. That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. That's a total departure from New Covenant thought. So I prayed under my breath, said, Lord, help me. I stepped back up to the counter. I looked at him, and I said, you know what, son? Your grandma's praying for you. And he got real quiet. He looked at me, tear dripping down his face. I said, your grandma's praying for you. Your grandma loves Jesus. She took you to church when you were a little boy. He started crying, and he said, what are you here for? I said, I'm here to preach the gospel to the church, but I'm here for you right now. Jesus loves you, and Jesus has died and rose again for you. And the young man said, if you'll excuse me, and he walked away and got somebody else to come help me. You see, you proclaim liberty to every inhabitant of your land. If he gets in my land, then he is going to be a victim of God's liberty. Praise God. Just absolutely victimize that homosexual spirit that has no right to be there. I don't know why he's in that. I don't know what his pain was, his rejection, his hurt. I don't know why he chose that, but it was evident it was dripping off of him, but he doesn't have to stay bound. Because when I stepped up there, the word of wisdom, word of knowledge came, and I began to see readily that he had a grandma that was praying for him. And when I spoke about his grandma, his tear began to flow down his cheek. He could not deny the reality of a grandmother that loved him. Praise God. So just think, proclaim liberty throughout all the land and to all the inhabitants thereof. You shall return every man to his possession. Now let's think about what's ours in Christ. All things are yours, 1 Corinthians 3:21. You are complete in him, Colossians 2:10. So I've returned to my possession. See, it's yours. Notice it's his. It belongs to you. Who got it for you? Jesus. How'd you get it? You got an inheritance. It came when he died and rose again. He gave you an inheritance. It belongs to you. And then every man to his family. And in the Hebrew language, the word family means species of being. So now we're returning. And this morning, just want to shout, you are not just human beings. You are born again, born of God, from above. You're from another realm. What's in you is far greater than anything in this natural realm. You are redeemed, and you are born of God, of incorruptible, indestructible, irresistible, irrefutable, invincible, never dying seed that cannot fail. The seed remains in you. And because that seed's in you, that's what's going to produce God's harvest in you. You're the ground. God's word is the seed, and Jesus is that word. You're free this morning. So this is what we learn from these verses. We put four thoughts down. Number one, the work is finished. The blood's on the mercy seat. We're not waiting for Yom Kippur in the natural. Jesus put his blood on the mercy seat 2,000 years ago. We're free now. So the work is finished. Number two, the witness of our faith must be in agreement with the blood on the mercy seat. Then number three, the will of God is freedom for every man, woman, boy, and girl. Jesus came to set the captive free. Jesus died to make men holy, but he lives to set men free. Jesus died to make men holy, but he lives to set men free. And then finally, the wealth of the Father is given to the family, and it belongs to us. So we're sounding these trumpets of healing, and the reason that we associate these trumpets with healing is because Paul said our body shall be changed at the last trumpet. And in order to have a last trumpet, you have to have preceding trumpets. So we're sounding these trumpets of healing in the church. Now, if you will, I'm just going to read my text and then I'm going to preach to you. Go with me to Deuteronomy chapter 25, and I'll thread these thoughts together. Deuteronomy 25. This is the first mention of stripes in your Bible. Very important. Very important. Deuteronomy 25:1. If there be a controversy between men, and they come unto judgment, the judge may judge them, and they shall justify the righteous and condemn the wicked. Oh, that's so important. And it shall be, if the wicked man be worthy to be beaten, that the judge shall cause him to lie down and be beaten before his face according to his fault by a certain number. 40 stripes he may give him, and not to exceed. So the Jews, wanting to keep the law, would never give any more than 39 stripes. That's very important. There are 39 books in the Old Covenant. And so he was preparing the way and the stage for Jesus to be stripes for the Jewish people. Jesus was not striped by Jews, but by Romans. The first 39 stripes that went on Jesus' back were to satisfy the old covenant and meet the demand of healing for the Jews. The next stripes that were put on Jesus' back, the multitude, was for the healing of the Gentiles. And bear him above these with many stripes, that thy brother should even seem vile unto thee. So notice that stripes are mentioned when there's a controversy between men. Then we're going to talk about healing in the new covenant. Go to 2 Corinthians 4. 4. 16. And here's the controversy in the new covenant. Most people miss this and they just accept this without further study. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4:16, for which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, here's your controversy, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. So in the new covenant, your controversy is not between an old and a new man, because the old man's dead. Do you believe that this morning? My old man was crucified with Christ on the cross. The cross did not do away with who I am, it did away with who I was. I'm a new man in Christ. I'm redeemed. I'm a new creature in Christ. This new creature God highly prizes. We are his workmanship created in Christ. The cross does not do away with me. It does away with who I used to be. Old man, old life, the cross did away. So then the controversy is not between an old and new man. The controversy here that Deuteronomy spoke of is between an outward man that perishes and an inward man that's renewed day by day. So simply said, what's going on in my spirit needs to get in my body. Now what most preachers will tell you is, look, God's doing something good in you spiritually, but your body is aging, decaying, and you're doomed. You're doomed. And there's no way out of it. Old age awaits you. And then we get all the cute sayings like, you know, that fellow right there, he's suffering from Alzheimer's disease. He's got more pains than a window. And begin to make jokes and make fun instead of realizing that that's not necessarily our fate. Now, I can't get you out of aging. If you live today and you wake up tomorrow, you're going to be a day older. Now, I'm going to give you a happy thought. You as young as you ever going to be right now. You ought to enjoy this. You ain't never going to be younger than you are right now. I mean, an hour from now, you're going to be an hour older. You ought to enjoy this. You're young. Think young. You're young. You're as young as you're ever going to be the rest of your days right now. Praise God. He renews my youth like the eagles. Praise God. Praise God. So preachers taught us, now that outward man, you know, you just have to, at 40 this happens, at 50 this happens, at 60 this happens, at 70 this happens, at 80 if you make it that far, you're on borrowed time. If you make it to 90, this happens, and you're just going to have to go that route. Now it is true that all of us will come to a place, if we stay in this realm, where we'll lay down our body. But that should be by faith, according to grace, and we should be quickened and strengthened in our body. So God did something about the controversy between the two men so that what's in our spirit can be done in our body. You see that? All right, then to Hebrews chapter 8, which you know this one well. Hebrews chapter 8. God did something about our body, and what's in our spirit can now flow into our body. And I want to show you that this morning. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 6. But now Jesus has obtained a more excellent ministry, contrasting him to Moses, by how much more he's the mediator of a better covenant, which was established on better promises. If the first covenant had been faultless, then no place should have been sought for the second. The Old Testament's God's word. We honor it. We receive it. We thank God for it. But there was a fault in it. Do you see that? If there was no fault in the first, there would have been no need for the second. Now watch what the fault was. For finding fault with them. The fault was not his word. The fault was with them. See that? The fault with them. There's nothing wrong with God's word in the old covenant. If you perfectly keep the law, every bit of it will work every time. The only problem is all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And if you break one point of the law, you're guilty of all the law. And therefore it won't work. Now watch what happens when God finds fault with them. He saith, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, I will make a new covenant. So when God found fault with them in the old covenant, he made a new covenant. Aren't you glad? I've never had anybody else deal with me that way. When people find fault with me, it's usually not very good. They don't seek to make a new covenant when they find fault with me. They seek to tear me apart. Behold, I make a new covenant with the house of Israel. Very important. And he says, and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt. So God has given us a new covenant. And the new establishes some things that the old does not have. And the new's better in every single way. And one of the graces of the old covenant, it was full of physical healing. I am the Lord that healeth thee, and I will take sickness from thee. I will bless thy bread and water. The Lord shall take away from thee all sickness, Deuteronomy 7:15. I will restore health unto thee and heal thee of thy wounds, Jeremiah 30:17. The Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in his wings, Malachi 4:2. It's all over the old covenant. So we have a better covenant. Spiritually, it's better. Mentally, it's better. Physically, it's better. Socially, it's better. And financially, it's better. And it's not worthy to be compared. If we really understood the new covenant without mixture, it's the most radical document that's ever been written. So the Lord, I've been saying this a lot about myself. You know, as you get older, you adopt some terms. I've been saying, man, I'm old school. And the Lord said, don't want you to say that no more. I want you to say your new covenant. I'm not old school anymore. I'm new covenant. I'm not old school. I'm new covenant. Praise God. One more verse, 1 Peter 2:24. Praise God, I'm new covenant. 1 Peter 2:24, and you know it well. Who his own self bare sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. You were healed. Now, let me just for a moment contrast the covenants. We have a better covenant. The old covenant is called old, and this is very simple, but the new covenant is called new. And that's much deeper than it sounds. Because new means ever fresh, ever ready, ever prepared, ever alive. The letter kills old covenant. The spirit gives life, new covenant. On the day the law came, 3,000 people died. On the day the Spirit came, 3,000 people were made alive. It's better in every way. In the old covenant, Job said, the thing I feared came on me. In the new covenant, I can say, the thing I feared fell on Jesus on the cross. In the old covenant, the holy man Moses, take off your shoes, the place you stand is holy ground. The holiest man of the old covenant had to take off his shoes in the presence of God. In the new covenant, the dirty, filthy prodigal comes from the pig pen, and the Father says, put shoes on his feet. In the old covenant, Moses couldn't stand in the presence of God in his shoes. In the new covenant, the prodigal gets the best shoes. You have a better covenant established on better promises. Now, this one's kind of heavy, so God, listen to it. In the old covenant, obedience is better than sacrifice. In the new covenant, praise God, sacrifice is far better than obedience. Do you know why? Do you know why? You have to know why. You know why? It's because in the old covenant, you had the animal's blood flowing. And what a man could do, his obedience was better than an animal's blood. But in the new covenant, you don't have an animal's blood anymore. You have Jesus' blood. And I'm going to tell you now, there's nothing you can do. 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 Not one thing you can do, not anything any of us can do that would ever equal or sequel or rival Jesus' blood. Not one drop. That blood is far greater than anything we can do. So in the old covenant, my obedience to God was more important than my sacrifice. But in the new covenant, the sacrifice he made for me is more important than my obedience, for all my obedience comes out of his sacrifice. We have a better covenant established on better promises. In the old covenant, God demanded a righteousness from you, but in the new covenant, he supplies righteousness to you. In the old covenant, the first prophet Samuel became a failure because he did not teach his children and was unable to impart to his children. In the old covenant, the first king was Saul, and he failed miserably, and the kingdom was rent from him. And in the old covenant, the first priest was Eli, and he became dim of vision and heavy of flesh. The first prophet, the first priest, and the first king failed. Old covenant. New covenant, the first prophet, Jesus. Praise God. He got up from the dead, and he is the spirit of prophecy himself, and he did not fail. The second king got up from the dead. I want to shout this morning, King Jesus is king, will ever be king, and he reigns as king, unchallenged, unquestioned, unparalleled, unprecedented. King Jesus did not fail. And then the priest Eli failed, but in the new covenant, seeing then we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith. Jesus is the prophet, priest, and king of the new covenant, and Jesus cannot fail. And it don't matter how many ways you look at it, the new covenant is superior in every way. They had the blood of a lamb, a ram, a bullock, a goat, an oxen, a sheep, and a turtle dove. Seven bloods. We have one blood. He shed his precious blood. One drop of Jesus' blood is greater than all seven of those animals and all the hundreds of thousands of drops of blood that they shed. One drop of Jesus' blood did for us what an animal's blood could not do. It's not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sin, but Jesus' blood does not just cover sin. It cleanses us. It washes us and makes white as snow. It cleans us and makes us completely free from sin. There's power in Jesus' mighty, holy blood. There's power in the blood of the Lamb. Praise God. In the old covenant, in 2 Samuel chapter 5, when David went into Jerusalem, David sold low the lame and the blind. The Jebusites put the lame and blind out in the streets, and David had to kill them to get into Jerusalem. But when David got into Jerusalem, he said, the lame and blind will never come into the house. That's the old covenant. In the new covenant, Matthew chapter 21, verse 14, the Lord Jesus, after he had turned over the money tables, he then said, let the lame and blind come. And the Bible would tell you in Matthew 21, 14, the lame and the blind came to him and he healed them. Where did he do it? He did it in the temple. I wish I had a preaching church in here this morning, man. In the old covenant, King David said, the lame and blind, let them die. In the new covenant, praise God, Jesus healed the lame and blind in the temple. We have a better covenant established on better promises. In the old covenant, Mephibosheth sat at David's table, but he never got his legs back. He fed on David's food all the days of his life, but never walked again. In the new covenant, take, eat, this my body broken for you. Drink this my blood shed for the remission of your sin. And if you feed at Jesus' table, you'll get your legs back. You'll get your mind back. You'll get your life back. You get everything back, because I am the Lord that restores. He'll restore you. We have a better covenant established on better promises. And what a disaster it's been for us to mix these covenants together. To rightly divide the word means that you're able to separate the old and the new. The first was taken away. The first man, Adam, the first message of the law, the first ministry of the high priest, and the first manifestation of all that was has been taken away. And now the new man has been established. Praise God. There's a new man. There's a new message. There's a new ministry. And there's a new manifestation because we have. We're not trying to get it. You have a better covenant. You are saved by grace. Praise God. Jesus dying the death of every man, suffering our curse. Jesus bore what we were, took that so we could receive who he is. Because of that, this new covenant's been established. And the most radical document that's ever been written is the new covenant. And preachers have been mixing the covenants for years. And I still do it. And I repent. And I'm sorry. I don't want to ever do that, but it causes great difficulty. Let me show you. I sat under a great preacher in the late 90s. He was a great orator, best orator I've ever heard. And he preached a series of messages that set me back 10 years. It set me back 10 years. This is what he preached. The holy and the profane. And he preached from the old covenant prophets that said, if the holy will touch that which is unholy, shall it still be holy? And the prophets would say, no, Lord. And he took that out and brought it over to the new covenant and then began to teach me that sin is contagious and righteousness is not. And after he got through with me, then every time I got around anything that was not holy and it touched me one way or the other, I'd look at something on TV. No matter what it was, it defiled my conscience and defiled me. He sent me back 10 years. Took 10 years to get past that one mixture of 1-6 series of cassette tapes. 10 years to get past that. But in the new covenant, when Jesus laid his hands on a leper, come on, this make anybody shout. You see, Jesus put his, Jesus is clean. Jesus is holy. And when what was holy put his hands on what was unholy in the new covenant, because Jesus is the new covenant. Jesus is the living, breathing revelation of a new covenant. When Jesus put his hands on the leper, come on, shout with me this morning. Jesus didn't get leprosy, but the leper got healing. So when I walk up to the counter with that boy there, what he's got's not going to affect me. I'm not going to walk away and battle with that. But praise God, what I got's going to bother him. What I got's going to affect him. Because in the new covenant, praise God, it's not the holy and the profane. It's the holy has power over the profane. Because Jesus is greater in you than any sin or anything in this world. He is greater than anything else. Jesus is greater in you. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. We have a new covenant. And it works that way spiritually, it works that way mentally, physically, socially, and financially. And so we've all been victimized by the mixing of covenants. We've all done it. But when you come to the end of the old covenant, the last word of the old covenant, you know what it is? What is it? Last word? Lest I come smite the earth with a curse. And that's what you end up with, the old covenant, a curse. And it finished on a tree because Jesus was made a curse. I'm spending all my time here. I'm not talking about healing a whole lot, but boy. In the old covenant, your sins, I'll visit on you, and I'll visit on your children and your children's children. And we teach generational curses. New covenant, your sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Praise God, you're free. I am not struggling today with what my great-grandfather did. It doesn't matter. Went on the tree. I am not under a generational curse. I've been freed from it. Praise God. I've been delivered from it. Because in the old covenant, see, a preacher that'll tell you that is thinking old covenant. He's preaching old covenant. And when you mix them, you get mixture. When you get mixture, that's not rightly dividing the word of truth. See? So your sins and iniquities will I remember no more. The last word of the old covenant's curse. The last word of the new covenant. Shout it out. What is it?
Amen.
That's the last word of the new covenant. Amen. So be it done unto me. I'm new covenant. How about you? Praise God. Jesus came, died the death, rose again, ascended on high, put his blood on the mercy seat. The work is finished. The witness of my faith, I agree with what he did. The will of God is freedom for every man, woman, boy, and girl. And the wealth of the family's been freely given. So it's time that we step into this and start walking in the reality of what is true of us based on the gospel. Praise God. So now, I'm sounding healing trumpets. Let me sound these for you very quickly. Trumpet number one sounds, God never changes. All he ever was, he is. Trumpet number two sounds. God made man without sickness and disease in the garden. Man was free in the image of God. Trumpet number three sounds. Sickness came through the fall, and all sickness in the earth is because of Adam's sin, not God's design. Trumpet number four sounds. God strategically placed sickness under the curse of the law so he could take that sickness and put it on Jesus to take it off of you. Trumpet number five sounds. There's healing in the old covenant. Trumpet number six sounds. Jesus came, and Jesus was living, breathing, walking, talking, healing, life in manifestation. Everywhere Jesus went, people got healed. Everywhere he went, people got delivered. Everywhere he went, people got set free. Jesus is living, breathing deliverance. He's power to set the captive free. He's power to deliver the sinner. He's power to forgive and discharge the debtor. He's power to bring glory. He's power to bring grace, and he's power to heal the sick. Jesus is alive. Praise God, he came, a living manifestation of the moving will of God. If you want to know the will of God, just look at Jesus. That's not hard. Number seven, stripes were laid on his back for the healing of the Jews, 39 stripes, and then the Gentiles and the nation. Number eight, trumpet sounds, the resurrection from the dead. Jesus got up, and when he did, his stripes were healed on the life side. Trumpet number nine sounds, Jesus is exalted far above all principality and power, might and dominion, every name that is named, not only in this world but in the world to come, and all things are put under his feet. Jesus is Lord over every sickness and disease. That's the gospel. Then the next trumpet sounds, the name of Jesus is glorified. Let me ask you a question. What can the name of Jesus not do? The precious name of Jesus is greater than any infirmity in this realm, no matter what that infirmity be. The name of Jesus is greater than any infirmity. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let every angel prostrate fall. Thank God, Jesus' name is greater than anything else. And the name was given freely that we might be saved, healed, and delivered and set free in Jesus' name. You agree? And then from the name, Jesus put every one of you in the healing ministry. Jesus said in Mark 16, verse 14 down through 20, he said, now you take your hands, holy hands, healing hands, helping hands. My hands are holy because his hands were nailed to a tree. My hands help because his hands were nailed to a tree. My hands have healing power in them because his hands were nailed to a tree. Blood flowed out of his hands to sanctify my hands. I can live one hand without wrath. You know why? Because God's not mad. And I can lift the other without doubting because I believe, praise God, I believe. A God loved me so much, he'd rather die for me than live without me. I could trust a God like that. My hands are holy. And Jesus put us all in the healing ministry. Jesus said, lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Your business to lay hands on them. Your business to say in Jesus' name, be healed. And your business is to walk away and trust God to make them well. That's your business. Next trumpet sounds, healing flows through the book of Acts. The stream flows. Jesus had this insatiable passion, Acts 1:3, when he rose from the dead after his passion to show himself alive by many infallible proofs. And all the way through the book of Acts, the healing trumpet sound, and everywhere they preached the gospel, the sick were healed. That's good news. Everywhere we preach the gospel, the sick should be healed. Do you believe that? Now, let's look at healing in the new covenant, this next trumpet sounds. Because some would say, well, now, Pastor John, every time they say that, you know you're about to get hit up with some real heavy unbelief. Well, now, Pastor John, and I do teach in seminary and I do teach in Bible college, so I hear some things that aren't necessarily in agreement with the new covenant. Pastor John, that healing's in the old covenant, but when I read the epistles, one man told me, very pious man, he said, when I read the epistles, I don't find healing in the epistles like you say it should be. If healing was a prevalent theme, then we should find it in the epistles to the church. We should find more healing in the epistles to the church, he says. I don't know why they talk like that, but they always do. By the time they get through, it's to the church. To the church. And it would seem to me, Dr. Cahill, that if this were a prevalent theme, as you would state and teach in your healing class, that perhaps it should be more prevalent in the scriptures. But in my studies of 45 years, I have not found nor discovered healing in the gospels and the epistles, as you say. Okay, praise God. How do you answer that? Well, here's how you answer it. It's in there. You just got to know what you're looking for. If you know what you're looking for, it's on every line and every page. First of all, anytime you see the name Jesus, you just saw healing. If you see the name Jesus, if you're reading, and Jesus took our sin, Jesus, wherever you see the name of Jesus, you could stop right there. That's spiritual, that's mental, that's physical, that's social, that's financial, and it's eternal. Jesus is everything in the new covenant. It's Jesus. So let me ask you a question, doctor. How many times is Jesus mentioned in the new covenant? And he said, well, I've never taken time to count, but several hundred, I'm sure. Then there's several hundred mentions of healing right there. Because you cannot have Jesus and not have healing. Jesus is healing. Jesus is healing. Jesus is healing. Jesus is peace. Jesus is strength. Jesus is power. Jesus is water to the thirsty soul. He's bread to the hungry. He's the way to the traveler. He is the diamond. He is everything. It's in the person. All the promises of God in him are yes, and in him amen, to the glory of God by us. If you see Jesus, you see healing. But very quickly now, here's how you find it in the new covenant. You first find any place where you'll see his sacrifice for his provision provided healing for us. Now let me show you this. Because Jesus was made a curse. Now we're beyond just talking now. Galatians 3:13, it is written. And when we go to what is written, we're beyond controversy. It's in the Holy Writ. Galatians 3:13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. It is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. So Jesus bore the curse spiritually, mentally, physically, socially, and financially. Deuteronomy 28:61. And I just pray you're soaking this in so you can just get your healing while you're sitting there. Deuteronomy 28:61. Moreover, the Lord God will bring upon you all these diseases until thou be destroyed, even the diseases not written in the book of the law. Now, Christ redeems you from two things there. Number one, from God putting sickness on you. God does not put sickness on you. He put that on Jesus on the cross. I'll wait for you to quit shouting. I was taught that God perhaps would use sickness as a teaching tool. And then I found out, praise God, the Holy Spirit, precious Holy Spirit, is the teacher of the church. And it's blasphemous to equate the Holy Ghost with sickness. Do you know that? That's blasphemous. Praise God. So Jesus then was made a curse with my curse. And Jesus took what was mine and gave me what was his. So Christ redeemed me from the curse. So anytime there's blood, anytime there's any mention of the death and sacrifice, you'll find there's always healing in it. Now I'm going to shout with you this morning, you are redeemed from the curse of the law. And the reason you're redeemed from the curse of the law, you heard it in our devotion, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. It's time we celebrate our redemption. The blood's on the mercy seat. I'm redeemed from sin. I'm redeemed from the weakness and frailty and the fallenness of broken, crying, dying humanity. I am redeemed, praise God. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Shout and say so. Amen. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Praise God. So anytime that you see the sacrifice of Jesus, you find his provision. It's there. Secondly, when you read through the new covenant, anytime that you see his stripes, there's a promise there. Now, please notice what we read in Deuteronomy 25. Very important. If two men in the old covenant come to judgment, then the judges would say, to the wicked you shall be beaten and you shall be striped to satisfy the righteous. That's old covenant. Now, let's go to the new covenant. I and Jesus have come to judgment, and Father demanded that Jesus be put down and Jesus be striped. And the righteous was beaten so the wicked could be justified. I'm going to quit, let you shout. I don't know what you're waiting on, but that's the best thing I've said all morning right there. My Lord, that ought to have brought you out of your seat. In the new covenant, the righteous man was striped so the wicked could be justified. And by those stripes, 1 Peter 2:24, which we read, by whose stripes you were healed, that enables God to take what's in your spirit and transfer it into your body, because stripes end the controversy between two men. And now you've got a right to believe that your body is rejuvenated, quickened, and made whole and healed in Jesus' name, for by his stripes you're healed. So I'm just going to sound a trumpet over you. By his stripes you're healed. By his stripes you're healed. Eldest member in here, you're healed. Youngest member in here, all the way down to Heidi, you're healed in Jesus' name. By whose stripes you were healed. God said by whose stripes you're healed. He didn't say maybe. He didn't say I'll think about it. He didn't say fast and pray. He said you were healed. 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 That's healing in the new covenant. Third place you'll find it is in Jesus seating. Jesus is seated at the right hand of God today. Ephesians chapter 1 will tell you, what is this exceeding great power that God wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead, set him down at his own right hand, far above, far above, far above all principality, power, might, dominion, every name that is named, not only in this world but in the world to come, and have put all things under his feet, and gave him to be head over all things to the church, his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Seated him at his own right hand. So when Jesus was seated there, God made him Lord of heaven, Lord of earth, and he's Lord under the earth. For every tongue, whether in heaven, earth, or under the earth, shall confess he's Lord to the glory of God the Father. Every demon, every force of darkness, every spiritual wickedness in high or heavenly places, it matters not. They all fear and tremble at the mighty, majestic, and marvelous name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is Lord in three worlds. He's Lord of the heavens, he's Lord of the earth, and he's Lord in the earth. Praise God. Everything is under his feet. He's unchallenged, he's unquestioned, he reigns omnipotent. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. He's mighty, he's holy, he's worthy, he's awesome, he's incredible, he's invisible. His name is Jesus. He is Superman. And there ain't nothing, nobody can stop him. He is far beyond what we know he is. His name is Jesus. But in Ephesians chapter 2 verse 4, you who were dead in trespasses and sin hath he quickened together with Christ. For by grace are you saved, for God is rich in mercy. And he not only quickened us, but raised us up together and made us, Ephesians 2, 6, sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, verse 7, that in the ages to come. Why did he do that? See, God reached down to the lowest pit, Psalms 88, 6, 7, lifted Jesus out of it because that was mine. He took him out of my place and put him in his rightful place. And God reached down as far as he could go, as far as his arm would go. That's the deepest place in Adam. Book of Revelation calls it a bottomless pit. Adam's a bottomless pit, and there's a lot of teaching you can get into there, but because there's no way out. A bottomless pit just means there ain't no way out of it. You can't get out. And God reached his hand to the end of the bottomless pit, lifted Jesus out of it, and raised his hand as far as he could go. You can go no higher than Jesus. Hebrews 7:26 said, he is higher than the heavens. And then when God raised you, he reached down, got you, he quickened you, he raised you, and he seated you in the heavenly places in Christ. And in that seating, he established serpents and scorpions under your feet. Now, we're going a little bit further. Luke 10:19, Jesus said, behold, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. So think of it this way. Your left foot on the serpent, your right foot on the scorpion. The serpent bites with his head. The scorpion stings with his tails. So smile, heads or tails, you win. You win, heads or tails. Who is he that overcomes? He that believes Jesus is the Christ. So all serpent, all of the curse, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. All that is associated with the serpent is under your feet right now. Now, who dare to believe that? Praise God, it's under my feet. Praise God, it's under my feet. Thank you for reminding us for that. Thank you for doing that this morning. You didn't know what I was going to preach, but thank you for doing that, for telling us again, this stuff's under your feet. This stuff does not have to rule us, dominate us, or control us. There is a power far greater than the powers of serpents and scorpions. It is the mighty, holy name of Jesus. Praise God. And your position is secure. And the only thing above you, if you're seated properly in Christ, is the head over the body. And he'll always be head, and you'll never be anything but the body. Here's another comparison to Old and New Covenant. Here's where preachers get messed up. Old covenant, they'll go back and preach, God will make you the head and not the tail. That's old covenant. Oh no, he don't make anybody the head in the new covenant. There's only one head in the new covenant. No, he don't make me the head in the new covenant. He makes me the body. So see, I can't be the head, but I'll never be the tail again. Come on, it's old covenant. Head and tail. No, I'm not the head. Jesus, head of all things. But I'm not the tail anymore either. Praise God, I'm not the tail anymore either. Hallelujah. I am in the body. Praise God. So my seating is secure. Then number four, to make this practical, because those things are done, established, those things are etherical to us. Those things we must believe by faith. But now here's where the experience comes in. The power of His Spirit that dwells in you. Now Romans 8:11 is a supernatural verse for the healing of the body. Romans 8:11. If the Spirit of Him that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you. Now let me ask you a question. Does the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you? Then he that raised Jesus from the dead by His Spirit shall also quicken your mortal body by His Spirit that dwelleth in you. Have you ever pulled a thumbnail into the quick? What happens? Came alive. That's the connotation of Romans 8:11. You became very aware of some life in that thumbnail that you didn't have before. You pull a thumbnail into the quick or a fingernail into the quick, it comes alive. And that's what he's saying. There's a life in you. Do you realize that in our practical, everyday walk, talk, living in this earth, in this fallen place, with pesticides on the food and with germs in the air and with everything that's around you every day, man, there's all kinds of stuff around you every day. The power to quicken your mortal body lives in you. And God wants that supply of the Spirit to be your energy, your strength, and your life, and to draw from that realm of Spirit. He wants the power of the Holy Ghost. One of His functions was to keep your mortal body well until you no longer need it. You can lay it down because you finished your course. That's why Paul, with everything he went through, with snake bites and shipwrecks. That's why in Philemon 1:9, the Bible would say, the aged old Paul, aged. He lived to be an old man. Why did he live to be an old man? Because he knew that he could not finish his course without the Holy Ghost working in him. And the Holy Ghost brought him and he said, I fought a good fight, finished my course. I'm ready now to be offered. That should be the way any of us get to the end of our journey, is we keep the faith. Praise God. And if anybody could have, would have, should have died as a young man, it should have been Paul. But if you'll read Philemon 1:9, it says aged there implies very old in the Greek. He was a very old man. And the reason he was a very old man is because. And then on top of that, he did not die. He laid down his life. He gave his life. He put his neck on that chopping block and they dropped the guillotine on him. He walked up there and surrendered his life because he knew his course was finished. He didn't die of old age. He didn't die of some disease. He died by giving his life. He was martyred. Praise God. And then finally this morning, His purpose and His salvation. Let's close this morning. Go to Romans chapter 5, verse 10. Let's turn there. Romans 5. Praise God. You getting your healing this morning? Receive your healing. These things are for us every day. Praise God. Controversy's over between two men. Praise God. My outward man's not perishing. My outward man's being renewed day by day. My youth is renewed like the eagles. How about you? Believe it? Now, if you're going to talk about all that other stuff, then you know, of course, death and life's in the power of the tongue. You know that. How important this is. How powerful this is. Look at Romans 5:10. If when we were enemies, this speaks of our past life, we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son. I was an enemy, but praise God for the cross where Jesus died. Praise God for the blood He shed. Praise God for the pain He suffered and the curse He took. We were reconciled by the death of His Son. You cannot bypass the death of His Son. I know some life preachers that just want to do away with death. You can never do that. This is not a death message. It's not a life message. It's a death and life message. The death of His Son. Much more. Now he's saying, as powerful as the death was, as incredible as the death was, as amazing as the death was, he says much more. Now I don't know how much more you can get than the cross, but he says much more. Much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by His life. Greek word, zoe, his life. I'm come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. We're saved by his life. Now, simple this morning, just from a concordance. S-O-Z-O, sozo, the pronunciation, S-O-D-E-Z-O, sozo. What he says, to be safe, to keep safe, sound, to rescue from danger, destruction, to keep one from injury or peril. Listen, to save a suffering one, one suffering from disease. Everybody see that? I'm just reading out of a concordance. It's one of the best ones you can get, Greek scholars. To save one from suffering from disease, to make well, heal, restore to health. To preserve one who's in danger of destruction, to rescue, to save in the biblical sense, to deliver from penalties of judgment, to save from the evils that obstruct the reception of the Messiah and his deliverance. But the thing I'm after, not all of your salvation, not all of it, but a part. And here's what I want you to see. God's interested in the whole of your salvation. The gospel is holistic. The gospel's for your spirit. It's for your soul. It's for your body. It's for your mind. It's for your emotions. It's for your finances. The gospel's for all of you. Don't limit the gospel to just one place. The whole of the gospel. This is only a part. It's not all of it, but it's an important part. And here's why it's important. It's Jesus took those stripes on his back, writhing in pain and agony, so he could heal your body. He did that so he could have a right to heal your body and put his life in that body, because your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. One suffering from disease, to make well, heal, and restore to health. That was God's purpose. God's purpose was to save from sin, to create a new man. God's purpose was to restore the mind and give peace. God's purpose was to heal the body and make well. God's purpose was to restore relationships and cause us to stop hating, fighting, backbiting one another. God's purpose was to lift man out of poverty and bless him so he'd always have everything he needed at all times. That was God's purpose. And Jesus came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. In Jesus' name, stand with me. That's far enough this morning. If you ain't got anything on healing by now, you're probably not going to get it today. Hallelujah. Now, this is an old covenant promise. I just want the first part of it. God prophesying here, listen to this. I will restore health unto thee and heal thee of thy wounds, saith the Lord, because they call thee an outcast. And some of us in this room have been called outcasts. We've been cast aside, pushed away, rejected, wounded, saying, this is Zion whom no man seeks after. And there's a lot of teaching you can do there. I'm interested in the first part of it. I'll restore health unto you, heal you of your wounds, saith the Lord. Some wounds are deeper than physical wounds. Some wounds are deeper. Some of us have been rejected. Some of us have been deeply cut, wounded, deeper, far deeper than just what could be a disease or a physical wound. The wounds of the soul can be deep. But he says here, I'll restore health to thee and heal you of your wounds. And with that word comes the trumpet that sounds, he was wounded for my transgression. He was bruised for my iniquity. The chastisement of my peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. I will restore health unto thee. So, if you've lost your health, if you've lost your health, if you've lost your health. I just took my annual physical this week, and you know, it kind of messes with your head when the kid that comes in the room looks like he could be your son. And he walks up to me and says, I'm Dr. Thomas, you know. He says, I'm Dr. Thomas. And I'm thinking, you but a kid. Kind of messes with your head a little bit. And I'm thinking to myself, do you shave? He nice looking young man, tall, nice looking young man, but really didn't look like he shaved. And I'm thinking, so what, 23? No, he's got to be older than that, because he's already got out of medical school and he's practicing. He's got to be older than that. And we sat and talked, and he asked me my age, and he looked at me, and of course he says, oh, take your shirt off, and he checks me and everything. He says, man, you're fit for your age. I said, yeah, God's good. And he said, I see on here what you had and where you come from, how you doing. So he took his time with me. I appreciated that. I really liked the young man. He took his time. We had a long, in-depth talk. And I said, I'm a pastor. And he said, well, I'm a believer too. And we started talking. And he said, so like when you got real close to death, did you have an out of body experience? And I said, no. I don't want an out of body experience. I want to stay in my body. I do not understand people wanting to have an out of body experience. I want to stay in my body. See, I want to go to heaven. I just don't want to go today. I know some people say, oh, I want to go to heaven today, and they spend every dime they got to stay here. I just want to be real with you. I want to live. I want to see Reese grow up. I want to be there when Reese graduates high school. I want to be there when she gets married. Yeah, praise God. Somebody said, what if the Lord comes? Praise God. I'm going to ask you a question. What if he don't? Come on, praise God. Either way, praise God. Some people worry about not having anything to worry about. It's ridiculous. So, he said, you have an out-of-body experience? And I told him, I said, no, son, I don't want to have an out-of-body experience. I want to live in this body. I want to live to be an old man. I want to fulfill my days in this body. I want to be strong and well. I want to be strong and well. And I talked to him about my healing, what God did for me. And with tears, I said to him, I said, I give God all the credit. I take no credit. I didn't have strong faith. Part of the time, you all carried me. You know that. You prayed. You know that it was you underneath. I was out in the hospital up there. I was drugged out. I couldn't believe for myself. I was in a place where I couldn't believe. And some of you carried. I'm so thankful that you did. But praise God. What a wonderful place to be this morning. He's restored health unto me and healed me of my wounds. Now, I've got some other wounds in different places I need to be healed of. We probably all do. But I want us to receive our healing before we go this morning. I want us to receive our healing. Now, at the end of the service, if you want prayer, we have some guests here that would love to pray for you. They asked me last night if they could pray and minister to you and bless you and come. And, you know, we're here for you. I'm here for you. I want your needs met. Whatever it takes to get your needs met. Now, if you can take this and walk out the door shouting and believe God, you're healed. You don't need hands laid on you. Praise God. You know what I'd tell you? Now, if you don't need hands laid on you, you go out there and lay your hands on somebody that does.
Come on.
All right?
Amen.
But if you do need help, don't pass an opportunity by. Don't pass an opportunity by. Now, these are some prophetic people, and they'd love to minister to you and pray for you, and I'll pray for you as I often do, and I do daily, but I stand here every Sunday and say, if you have a need, you want prayer, come forward, have hands laid on you. Most of the time, most of you don't. But don't walk out the door till you've received your healing and your wounds are healed. Amen? Can I have a meager amen? All right, let's receive. Father, in the name of Jesus, from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet to the end of my fingers, I present my body a living sacrifice. I thank you that it's made holy and acceptable unto you through my Lord Jesus Christ, by his mercy, by his grace, by his anointing, by his power. I trust the Lord Jesus today. And Lord, with all of the death and all of the suffering and all of the weakness that I hear and all of the pain that's now in people even close to me, Lord, I thank you for comforting them. But Lord, I thank you that you are bringing forth a mighty deliverance in Zion. You're causing a people to rise and take their place with serpents and scorpions under their feet in Jesus' name, strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And so in this congregation right now, or any of you watching by internet, any of you that are watching, God bless you this morning, my internet audience. I greet you in the name of Jesus. Receive your healing. Amen. Receive your healing. There are some of you watching, you need to receive your healing. It's being freely offered. It's being freely given. It's flowing because blood flowed. It's flowing because stripes were laid on his back. You have a new covenant, and in that new covenant, he says, by whose stripes you were healed. So from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet to the end of your fingers. If it's your heart, in the name of Jesus, I receive healing in my physical heart. If it's your kidney issue, in the name of Jesus, I receive healing in my kidneys. Be specific. Just take a moment and receive it. If you're having back trouble, knee trouble, you're having headaches, neck ache, whatever it is, in the name of Jesus, I just receive my healing right now. By his stripes, I'm healed. Receive it. Blood sugar come down. Blood pressure come down. Blood stream be made whole in Jesus' name. And Lord, I bless you and I praise you and I thank you, Lord. Let your healing virtue flow. You that are watching by internet, be healed in Jesus' name. Just receive your healing. I know because I talk to many of you on a regular basis, in the name of Jesus, by whose stripes you're healed. By whose stripes you're healed. And this is a favorite verse of mine here, Psalms 105:37. Jehovah brought Israel out with silver and gold, and there was not one feeble one among their tribes. Not one feeble one. God, give us strength today in Jesus' name. Father, give us strength. Now let's go a little bit deeper than that in the name of Jesus for the wounds of the soul. Lord, as I meditated this morning, some things in my heart, Lord, there's still some things there that need to be healed. Lord, I just present these wounds to you now. And you have to be honest with the Lord. Don't try to hide or don't try to, you know, don't try to be cool with the Lord. Just be real. Lord, this, name it. This hurts me. This hurts. Just put that before the Lord. Lord, I know what mine is right now. Lord, it hurts. I could tell you my heart hurts for Jackie this morning. My heart's heavy. I said, Lord, that hurts me that Sherry died at 56, 57 years old. Lord, it hurts my heart. Big smile, prophetic psalmist, amazing woman of God, great lady, a dear friend, a sister in Christ. I'm heavy for Jackie. Lord, in the name of Jesus, much greater than healing my hurt, heal Jackie's hurt today. Heal Jackie's hurt. Dr. Graves hurt. Todd Cubitt's, Lord. Go a little deeper, Lord. Heal my hurt. There's some of you got some deep scars on your soul. I saw them last night. I came over to pray for a little while last night. I saw deep scars, deep wounds. Lord, he says here, I'll heal thee of thy wounds. Deep scars. Bring peace there. Bring healing. Bring help in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Now, if you'd like these to minister to you, anyone that would you come forward now? Just come on. If you want prayer this morning, come on. Before I dismiss the congregation, we'll bring you this way first. I'd like to have hands laid on you for anyone. Give prophetic words and things of that nature. I know there's several of you that need to come. Some of you are having trouble receiving. Anyone? Just come. Come quickly. I'm not going to belabor this. Come, if you need help, it's good to get help. Man, I'm telling you, it's just good to get help. If you need help, come get help in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. If you want prayer, come this way. I'm going to dismiss you in just a second. Please be reminded that we're going to meet tonight around 6 o'clock. We're just going to get in the Spirit. We're not going to be preaching so much as we're just going to get into the Holy Spirit and ask Him to work and make this stuff real to us. And I don't say it irreverently, this gospel real to us in Jesus' name. So, Father, thank you for the Open Door family. Thank you for all those that were here today. Thank you for the children, young people. Thank you for every person in this auditorium right now and the seed that was sown. I thank you for ministering to them, meeting their need, blessing them, helping them, strengthening them in Jesus' name. Thank you. They walk in strength. I thank you. Larry's here today. Lord, thank you for touching his family the way you did and his brother going home to be with the Lord. Thank you for touching Larry this morning in Jesus' name. And God, I just thank you for meeting the needs of the family, meeting the needs of the people. We give you glory and honor and praise in Jesus' name. And we said together, amen. All right. Amen. Thomas, if you and Teresa, would you come up and just stand with them, please? Teresa, if you'll come and minister to them. They're going to pray for people. If you want to stay, you can. Sheila's going to play. If you need to go, we release you in the name of Jesus. Hope to see you back tonight. God bless you in Jesus' name.